welcome to Engine Shed. For those of you with your first time, an even warmer welcome. My name's Nick Sturt, I'm director of Engine Shed, and my job is just to do a very quick kickoff to the session today. Before I do that, I do need to do the health and safety piece, which is that the toilets are just there or in that corner. But perhaps more importantly, if you hear the fire alarm and we're not expecting a drill, please evacuate the building promptly. It's a high-risk building, there's a lot of wood in it. The assembly point is behind the containers in that direction. There's an exit behind you and in that corner or the front door. That's health and safety done. I'm going to also mention the next event after this, and the details are on there. We're going to look at bringing the scale-up agenda, the new government's kind of emerging initiative about helping companies scale up, with inclusive growth agenda from the RSA and how those two work together, which is an important issue for Bristol. So that's in February. That'll be the next event after this, and the details are online. We are also videoing the event for posterity. I'm sure it'll be used, and the LEP are putting it on their website, so that's great. So, why have we got you here together today? We've got an interesting mix of people, which is great. What we really want to do as Engine Shed is provoke thinking, bring different people together to think differently, and hopefully take things away which make the world we live in one small bit, a bit better. The Bristol way is to do things differently, so hopefully we'll get a bit more of the Bristol way out of this. That's all I'm going to say. I'm going to hand over to Ed, who's going to take you to the next stage.
Thank you very much, Nick. By way of introduction, my name's Ed Rowberry, and I'm Chief Exec of Bristol and Bath Regional Capital. I'm delighted to be joined by yourselves, obviously, and also a panel of, I think it was luminaries, so guys, you can take that if you like. So, Sue Turner, Chief Exec of Quartet, Ollie Mochizuki, founder of Fundsurfer, Nick Davis, founder and Chief Exec of Neighbourly, and Carl Bellazare, Managing Director of Social Enterprise Works. Each of these guys will give you a fuller introduction to themselves, why they do what they do, their organisations, and we'll give you some thoughts in a second. What I thought I'd do is, just by way of introducing the subject, just think a little bit about what do we mean when we're saying it's easier to socialise the commercial than it is to commercialise the social. So one of my non-execs, a couple of years ago, kept saying this phrase to me, and I'll be quite honest with you, I didn't know what he was talking about, and it's taken me this long to actually really think about and understand. And actually, maybe we still don't. Maybe actually the outcome of this discussion is actually we're going to still need to explore it and understand it better. But let's have a go at enlightening that phrase, let's have a go at discussing it, and there will be 20 minutes or so for quick Q&A for questions at the end. Just a little bit about Bristol and Bath Regional Capital. And I explain Bristol and Bath Regional Capital in two ways, and I'll explain it in these ways to illustrate the point slightly. Both are true. So the first way is Bristol and Bath Regional Capital. We are an investment company. We're owned by some of the large institutions of this region. We've raised £1 million as a structured bond. We're currently raising about £8 million in investment for clients. And over 10 years, we seek to raise about £100 million and retain and attract investment into the region. So what? So, quite literally, so what? Are we just are we a financial intermediary? Are we trying to be a new bank? Are we trying to create or exacerbate the issues that we face in this world through the banking system? Well, no. Let me tell you the other version of events. Everything that we've funded so far, or everything that we're funding at the moment, seeks to help society move forward in a positive way, and a positive way for all. So we're seeking to fund things where young people have the opportunity to play sports who otherwise wouldn't have access to those facilities. We're seeking to provide opportunities for those who have fallen off the societal ladder and actually has gone as far as prison to find employment via trades in the property development trade. We're seeking for those who actually have emerging mental health issues or serious mental health issues to have access to counselling facilities within the community. And we're also seeking to house people who are essential workers for our society, whether they be medical staff, whether they be teachers, to give them a secure tenancy, a tenancy where they know it's a home, where they know that the rents are going to be reasonable and predictable, and they get a decent quality of accommodation. what I'm trying to illustrate by that point is to say, yes, in the first example, we are an investment intermediary. We raise money primarily, we do other stuff. But actually, it's about our purpose. The why we do it, that's the reason I get out of bed in the morning, and that is, I think, what this new economy is about. So let's unpick this phrase, socialise the commercial and commercialise the social. Let's think about the how a little bit. I think there will be lots of different ways of dividing society. You might look traditionally at the charitable sector, and the charitable sector actually needs to make itself more resilient. Sue will probably be able to talk a lot more in depth about that than I will. And therefore, you'll see the charitable sector looking at building and creating social enterprises, enterprises that generate a revenue stream which reduces reliance on grant funding. Look at the state. The state actually seems to be running low on funds. So in certain cases, it's spinning out certain services. Those certain services are raising what's called social investment and are being delivered in a different way. But I think, and let's debate it, this event is about a third part to that equation. And that part of the equation is around business, for-profit business, and profit-for-purpose business. And the statement, it's easier to socialise the commercial than it is to commercialise the social, is saying actually that this type of profit-for-purpose thing is actually easier to achieve than the other two that I mentioned, the charities and the state actually turning themselves into commercial thinking organisations. Discuss. And I'm not expecting everyone to agree with that statement, by the way. So, let's just give you some quick examples, and I'm going to hand over to the panel members. I can commend two publications to you, which are over there, first come, first serve. I don't think there's enough for everyone. One, which Sue will talk about, is the Vital Signs Report and Quartet. That will expand a little bit about what we mean by societal need. And in my view, it's been done in a business-like way to actually understand the problem before trying to seek a solution. Also, this publication, Purpose. There's about 30 or 40 over there. Purpose is looking at this third category of for-profit businesses and can they get more engaged with purposeful activity. I'm going to read you some stats briefly. 130 billion is the amount that more purposeful business could add to the UK economy according to a London Business School study, publicly supported by the chief economist of the Bank of England. 72% of global consumers will recommend a company with purpose to others. 87% of business leaders believe that companies perform best over time if their purpose goes beyond profit. 113% is the margin by which purposeful brands outperform the stock market. 62% of UK millennials will want to work for an organisation with a positive impact on the world. Unilever's purpose-led brands are growing at twice the pace of the rest of its portfolio. 92% of global high net worth individuals believe that thoughtful investment is an important way to drive social impact. And 3.5 billion is the current size of the UK social investment market. So you can read that at your leisure. I don't want to overload you with data. But just by way of illustration, there are some hard, well-researched facts by some eminent authorities that actually say if businesses think about this sort of stuff in an intelligent way, it's actually going to drive the bottom line in a sustainable way and ultimately shareholder value. So, is it easier to socialise the commercial or commercialise the social? I'll leave you all to decide when we finish this discussion. What I'd like to do now is, having made that introduction, hand over to the panel members one by one. I'm going to start with Sue, and if all panel members could sort of address the same questions I'm going to address to Sue, and I'll remind you if necessary. So Sue, could you tell us a little bit about yourself, why you do this, your purpose in running Quartet, a little bit about Quartet, and perhaps a thought around the topic and maybe a challenge or however you want to play that.
Okay, thank you. Oops, come on. Thank you. Thanks for the introduction, Ed. I'm really keen to talk with you about motivation, and I'll explain why. I think it's perfectly valid to have a motivation which is about making a business that makes profit. Profit is where we get a lot of our taxes from, and taxes can be used for all sorts of social good. So I don't have a problem. The background I come from is private sector as well as not-for-profit sector. So for me, profit can be a very good thing. So I don't have a problem with that as a basic concept. But I think it's what underlies your motivation for doing what you do that's where things get really interesting. My own motivation is pretty straightforward. I grew up in the northwest of England, in Bolton, in a not very advantaged family. So a parent, mum's a nurse, an old brother and sister who both went to the local state school, which you could only describe as a sink school. It really was appalling. Instead of getting the kids getting told off if they turned up at school without their homework, the kids got beaten up by the other kids if they turned up at school with their homework. So it was my destiny at the age of 10 to follow my brother and sister into this same school. But I happened to take the exam for the local, very academic, fee-paying school, and they offered me a place. But of course, coming from the background I did, there's no way we could pay the fees. But some local philanthropists had organised an assisted places scheme, and because of that, I got to go to an incredibly good school and had a phenomenal education. And because of that, I was the first person in my family to go to university when I came to Bristol here to study law. And because of that, all the other things that have happened to me in my life have stemmed from. So I am living proof that local philanthropy really does work. And hence in my job today, which is all about finding people who want to be philanthropic in the local area and finding the right good causes to match their money to, it's a joy and a pleasure to do what I do. And I think my motivation probably needs a little further explanation. I'm giving back for all the good things that have been given to me over the years. And just as a point about community foundations, how many of you, quick hands up, anybody understand what a community foundation is? Ah, a few. Okay, well, pretty informed audience then. Most places I go to, it's about two hands that go up, so a lot more here. But I'll just very briefly explain how the first community foundation in the world got set up, and then I think that will make you understand what it is that we do. The first one in the world was set up by a guy called Frederick H. Goff in Cleveland, Ohio, in 1914. And he got fed up with his friends, his contemporaries and his predecessors dying and leaving money in their wills or giving money during their lifetimes and putting it in trusts, which were very tightly constrained according to the needs that people perceived at the time. And the classic example is the education of the children of chimney sweeps. And at one point in time, that was a really good thing to aspire to save money and have money to do. But over time, it became redundant. And Frederick Goff was really frustrated with this. And he said, we can't predict what's going to happen in the future. So why don't we have a central pot, let's call it a community foundation, which we can put our money into in our lifetimes and in our wills. And then we'll rely on those people who come after us to decide where to apply the money according to the needs of the day. And that's how the first community foundation was set up. They've been going for just over 100 years in Cleveland, Ohio. They have an endowment, a permanent endowment of $1.8 billion, and they've spent $1 billion in the 100 plus years since they were set up. So they're the big daddies of what we do. Here in the west of England, our endowment is £24 million, so babies by comparison. But we've given out £40 million in grants since we started 29 years ago. And it's about £2.5 million a year that we give out to small, local, good causes. They don't even have to be registered charities because we have a very good due diligence process to work out who to give money to. We're a social enterprise ourselves. We have a cafe on the ground floor of a building which produces a good income and allows us to subsidise the rest of our building to good causes so they don't pay commercial market rent to have city centre office space. And some of the grants we give out go to charities and good causes that think they might want to become social enterprises. So we're helping people go down that path into social enterprise. I've got lots more statistics I can share with you, all sorts of information if that's relevant to the panel session. But what I wanted to do was share a bit of a conundrum with you, if I may. The government is very keen to incentivise more philanthropy, whether that's from businesses or from private investors. The vast majority of our £24 million has come from private philanthropy, individuals rather than companies. There are one or two companies that are the exception, including the Bristol Port Company, which is where I worked before I came here. They have a £360,000 endowment with Quartet, so that's the exception though. Most companies don't have things like that. But the government wants to incentivise more companies to get involved, whether it's in social enterprise or in supporting charity and philanthropy. Now, my experience is that businesses rarely do this. As we approach the 30th anniversary of the foundation, I've been digging back through the records, looking at how we came to be started and what the history tells us. Actually, the first report that was done to see whether a foundation ought to be set up was commissioned by the Society of Merchant Venturers in the 1980s. And looking back through that, really interesting statistics that I found. It went out to 300 business leaders as a postal questionnaire, and only had a 13% response rate. Now in those days, of course, much more deferential society, if you've got a questionnaire from the merchant venturers, you ought to fill it in. But this only got a 13% response rate. 24% of the businesses who responded were opposed to the idea of setting up a community foundation. Only two companies thought that they were very likely to make a financial contribution into the fund were it to be set up. 25% thought, well, we'll let our staff do events and activities and raise funds and we might contribute that. But 60% said they wouldn't make any sort of financial contribution, not even donating prizes for a raffle. Now, we might say, oh, that's in the 1980s and things are very different today. Of course, we would behave differently. But actually, that's not my experience. There's an old adage that says, when it comes to charity, most people will stop at nothing. And that's so true. They stop at nothing. And that's what I find with most businesses today. They want to get something from the arrangement. I understand that. So their motivation is more about getting rather than giving. They want to find a way to get more users or customers for their product or services. They want to impress employees and retain them, perhaps using them from volunteering or ticking the boxes about employee engagement. And where they do support social enterprises or charitable causes, they want to avoid reputational risk. So what do? They go for the large charities, the big well-known brands that they feel they can trust. And that means small local charities of the sort that the Community Foundation supports don't get a look in. They've not got a chance of being on that list of being the charity of the year that the fundraising committee might give money to. And that risk aversion is really damaging. And that's why the Community Foundation exists. So we can be the broker and do the due diligence and de-risk the arrangement through our extensive knowledge. That works for individual philanthropists, but for businesses, they'd want to get so much more out of the arrangement. Now, the social enterprises we support, they are very focused, by contrast, on the people they're trying to help. So they're focused on giving. What support can they give? What advice? What help? And quite often they can be focused to the point where they're resistant to change, resistant to a potential new funder coming in, wanting to help them and support them, but change some of the things that they do, change, frankly, some of their values. They don't have time, quite often, let alone the skills, to figure out a new way of working because it would suit a business funder. So there's a mismatch between the two. And I think that's one of the real issues, that the giving and the getting sometimes can't find a way to meet in the middle. Now, I'm hopeful that people like you, who've got perhaps a more entrepreneurial spirit, a more giving spirit, the reason you're here today, will feel differently. And what I was saying to the Office for Civil Society last week is that don't focus on the large corporates and trying to get them to change, because they're not going to change in any significant way. Focus on people like you, who've got ideas, energy, want to do things differently. Where you lead and the big corporates see that you're doing things differently and having success, they will follow. So my suggestion to you is that I hope you're well motivated to give more than to get, and that you will lead the corporate sector where it needs to go.
Thanks, Sue. That's great. Good challenge there for everyone. So, Nick, could I pass to you? You've got extensive experience of working with large corporates and other things. And
okay.
I don't know if you want to disagree. Or
you wanted controversy. Right. That's working. That's not working.
Press it again.
You have to get close to your mouth.
Twice. Is that working?
No, take it until the orange light's off, because it's on
off.
Mute.
Until the orange light is off.
So, Nick, just as a reminder, a little bit about yourself, a bit about Maberly, and then if you'd like a riposte.
Okay, not a riposte. An idea on collaborating. Right, so I'm Nick, I'm the founder of Maberly. Maberly is a social platform which is designed to connect community projects to stakeholders who have anything to give, whether they've got time to volunteer, whether they've got funds to donate, whether they've got food surplus that they want to contribute, and that can be at a company level, or that could be at an individual level, that could be at a local council level. It's basically about putting together those that have the means with those that have the needs at a local community level using technology. My background is, I'm a marketeer by trade, but I suppose the more interesting insight is, I suppose, the journey that a number of us have been on the Maberly team, which is what we see in society is that there are so many remarkable stories of what people can do when they are motivated to do so. So many people have their own personal story, their own reason why they're motivated to give in the community where they live. And so many of those stories are incredible with regards to the contribution that people will make. How do we capture those stories? How do we share them? How do we make more people understand and celebrate those amazing things that can happen? And therefore, perhaps potentially motivate other people to follow on. And when I say people, I actually do mean business, and this is where I will respectfully disagree with Sue. I think business is on a massive journey to reinventing itself towards making a contribution at a community level, quite simply because CSR is dead. There's point number two from a controversy perspective. If you're still practicing CSR, your business won't be here in 4 or 5 years' time, because that is simply ticking the box. It is going through the motions. It is suggesting that you don't take it too seriously, and therefore you're prepared to have another department that looks after this, because it's not systemic within your business. If it's not systemic, you won't be able to be a responsible, purposeful business. You won't recruit the right staff, particularly millennials, in the future, which compromises your future talent and your future ability to compete. You won't understand the concepts of decoupling and recognising that actually the resources in this planet are finite, and we've got to find a way of respecting people and planet, as well as shareholders, and returning against all of those three in ways that do no harm. And unless you're a business that's thinking about moving in this way, you simply will lose market share. In saying all of that, I give myself away as being a B Corporation and proudly wearing the badge, because B Corps are companies that commit to transparency, to do no harm, and to make sure that we are delivering against those three fundamental stakeholder groups. And that is, I think, the way all business will go in the future. We're one of the first 50 in the UK, and we were, what's the word? We were awarded our plaque September last year. Where does this go now? We're getting to a place on Navy where we really are activating campaigns at scale. We're showing that business does have an appetite to find ways to connect at a community level, because people want to know how business makes a contribution where they live. Everything else they do, perhaps internationally, is important. But it's also important, particularly in the current climate, to show that you care in the communities where you operate. And we're really scaling up some of the programs that we're doing with fantastic brands like Marks and Spencer's, Heineken, The Body Shop, even Starbucks, who actually do incredibly authentic things in the communities where they operate. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Nick. Yeah, very well articulated. I think let's go to Ollie next. And Ollie, you obviously have a keen awareness of various sectors, but particularly the fintech sector and social enterprise sector. Do you want to say a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, sure.
Your organisation, and perhaps reflect on some of the thoughts, or give your own new thoughts into the equation?
Yeah, absolutely. So Fundsurfer is a crowdfunding and commercial finance platform. So when we created Fundsurfer, initially it was just crowdfunding, but I came from an equity finance background, and it just became really clear immediately that, you know, all of our clients needed access to a much wider range of funding options. But for me personally, you know, I came into this, in my soul, I'm an entrepreneur. I was the kid that was importing American candy from relatives in the States when I was 8. I was selling secondhand cars when I was 14 years old. I had to have a friend who had a driving license to be able to take me to go and buy them and take me to the scrapyard to buy the bits that I needed to get them fixed and sell them for a ridiculous profits, frankly, for a 15-year-old kid. So for my background, for me, crowdfunding and fintech and the democratization of funding has been, you know, it was a light bulb went on. I crowdfunded, I think it was £3,500 for a short film when I was at film school in 4 days. And for that for me really showed where we were gonna go. And, you know, we see that crowdfunding has built this funding escalator that goes all the way to the ground floor. But I've always, you know, loved helping organizations and amazing ideas get the funding they need. And with Fundsurfer, you know, we offer everything from, you know, Chinese investment from our 2,000 Chinese partners to sponsorship, you know, in a similar way to how Nick said, we're very focused on trying to steer both big companies and small local businesses to put their money, you know, where it can have the most impact. We're doing a lot of work with impact investing, which, you know, is growing to a point now. I think it's $80 billion is the global impact investing market. And we're seeing so many combinations of funding being deployed, and charities having to, you know, really look at how they commercialize themselves. But that said, you know, that throws up a number of, you know, difficult issues. You know, how do you tell a small charity that's volunteer-led to be more like Google? You know, it's not going to work, and it's not going to happen. You know, a lot of these organizations that we support, you know, really small. They have, six volunteers, one paid staff, their turnover's under 100,000, so, you know, they're not eligible for social investment tax relief that I got very excited about when it came out. I then spent 6 months profiling 70 social enterprises. Two were eligible for social investment tax relief. You know, they weren't turning over £150,000 a year. So my motivation has always been about supporting projects, helping to steer money in the right place. And I think where we sit right now, I think we can all agree 2016, you know, is drunk and should go home. And it's been a horrendous year for many people. But I think the line has never been clearer between the Rebel Alliance and the Death Star. And when I say that, hopefully don't tweet this, guys. You know, I have to go in rooms of venture capitalists and not say this stuff. But being, you know, serious for a second, it's a very, very tough place out there. But there is hope. You know, impact investing is delivering for social, for environmental impact. And with companies like FunSurfer, Neighbourly, Social Enterprise Works, Quartet, you know, we're seeing packaging of project financing from a number of places. And, you know, I think that we all need to just keep pushing in this direction, working together and supporting charities that need to be more commercial and commercial organisations that need to operate more like charities and have a social vision and a focus.
Thanks, Ollie. That's great. So good Star Wars plug in there as well.
Got to get one in.
Yeah. So last but not least, Carl, you're very, very active in the social enterprise space and have been for many years. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself, your organisation, and your thoughts on the discussion so far?
So, my name is Carl Benazer. I'm a managing director of a 23-year-old development agency called Social Enterprise Works. We're primarily about supporting a strong social economy to thrive. So not exclusively just social enterprise organisations, but more about driving a more socially driven economy forward. And I guess a bit of a movement of what I regard as changemakers. I think there is a groundswell of people that are driven by things other than just money. And we typically, they land at our site on a daily basis. But that being said, alongside the training, advice and consultancy that we offer, helping people with the skills to become more enterprising just isn't enough. We're in a very interesting place. People very clearly understand what a charity is. They very plainly understand what a business is. But this social enterprise thingy in the middle is often very misunderstood. And I guess that presents part of the challenge for the topic today. We've been doing a number of things so far as trying to brand our city as a social enterprise city, hosting networking events, lobbying the LEP to try and do more to support the sector. Even hosting a pop-up market just out on the front here to try and raise more awareness with the general consumers and the general public about what social enterprise and the difference that a socially driven organisation makes. But there's still much, much work to be done. And personally, to go back to the topic at question, I personally feel that it's easier for a social enterprise to develop a business model than it is for a business, particularly a big business, to develop genuine purpose and value at its core. Building upon what Nick was saying, and I know he's working sort of furthering this agenda about going beyond CSR, personally I think that most businesses are driven by money, quite plainly. So therefore trying to convince the founder of a profit-driven organisation that actually there's something more important than shareholder value is a difficult mix. Now, that being said, when it comes to impact, larger organisations that are very commercially savvy are in a much better place in many respects to achieve impact at scale, as Nick was suggesting. If you're a conglomerate with lots of networks of offices and people, you could deploy them much easier than a smaller organisation or social enterprise can do. And equally, going back to this thing about being able to trade, it's very increasingly hard for social enterprise organisations that are constantly having to explain who they are, why they're different, and why they're distinctively different from the next business to them, to achieve those sales and trades in order to make them more effective, I suppose, so far as being able to be more commercial. So, personally, I think that it's not one or the other. We've been working quite closely with the Bristol Junior Chamber of Commerce, for example, to look at how we collaborate across sectors. And Ollie, as Ollie was saying, I think that we need to encourage and support more social and community organisations to be more enterprising, and more businesses to be more social. And actually, the I think we need to, the lines are blurring somewhat, and we need to continue to move forward together, really, and put our sectors side to side, and the wicked problems that are being faced in society can only be faced if we all collaborate together. So that's my view. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Carl. So let's just have a few more debates between us as a panel before we open up for wider questioning. I think, just listening to what you've all said, one of the key determinants in answering this question is around the ability to shift a culture. I think, Carl, you picked up a little bit on cultural shift and the relative cultural shift from a charity becoming more commercial being perhaps easier than a cultural shift away from perhaps a pure profit motive or a profiteering motive. So I guess I'll throw it out to the panel openly, and first one to get the microphone close to their mouth can answer.
I'm going to weigh this one.
Is that true? Is it a big question of cultural shift? And if so, what are the practical things that can be implemented to achieve that cultural shift in any of those sections of society?
Motivation.
Motivation. Okay, what do you mean?
Well, I think Sue very nicely alluded to it from the start. And one of the things often when I'm working in communities to help people understand the differentiator between a classic private business and a social enterprise is their motivation, the why they exist and what they do with the money. And again, I guess within changing the culture, which is obviously inevitably complex, I think that having the right motivations for wanting to do so. And I'm a little bit torn at the moment. There's this sort of B-team movement where you've got lots of very classic capitalists, Richard Branson, CEO of Puma and others, saying that what's good for people and the planet is good for my bottom line. And as you're suggesting, a number of organisations are doing the same. They're starting to acknowledge that having some level of purpose is actually quite profitable. So cynically, lots of organisations are changing their culture around to becoming more social, but perhaps for the wrong reasons. So I think having the right motivation would be quite important to help change and bring about a positive cultural change.
Nick, would you like to pick up on that point?
Where do I start? So it is easier for social enterprises to be more commercial. That's definitely true. If you are a global multinational company, it's going to take a long time to turn that super tanker around. But I think to this point of, is what's good for the planet good for society, good for business, is that really true? It's proven consistently. And I'll give you just a couple of really simple examples. If you allow your colleagues, your staff, if you're a retailer particularly, to volunteer in ways that they choose in their local community, the net contribution of that drops straight through to the bottom line in terms of reduced sickness, reduced churn, net saving on the bottom line. Really simple cost justification for allowing more volunteering and employee-empowered volunteering. If you take that a little bit further and start to think about how you might redistribute your waste, your surplus, whether that's food or anything else that you've got to give, that creates a reputational opportunity by causing people to think, actually, that's useful, well played, Company X, you've done something that's purposeful for society. If you scale that up and then make that about donations that are done in an increasingly authentic and sophisticated way, and that's the important point, then you really do get to a place where consumers start to say, I have a choice. I'm not really motivated by plastic and loyalty schemes anymore because they're ubiquitous. But if I find a business that's genuinely trying to improve things in the community where I live, maybe I will actually back them up and say thank you and start to recognise that contribution. When it comes to societal shift, that's the bit that I'm impatient for. I wish society recognised the power that sits within this room, within this city, within this nation, to encourage brands along the right trajectory to do the right thing. We just need to learn to say thank you and recognise they genuinely want to make a contribution. We just need to learn that actually, in the spirit that is on this stage, it's all about collaboration, getting as many of those stakeholders to work together, because together we can unlock incredible potential all the way across community. I think what business has to give in terms of inspiring this movement and behaviour change is scale for good and brilliant creative agencies and decades of learning how to influence people. Yes, cynically, perhaps in the past to create more sales, but now the opportunity is to say, let's use those skills to actually use our brand leadership to help people find a way to make their contribution by creating lots of little campaigns that are fun and inspiring and actually cause us all to think, yeah, I could do that. I could join in. That's the power of big business, changing behaviour in millions of people that are their customers at scale and doing it quickly, but only because they're motivated to do so by thousands of small social enterprises that are nibbling away by doing this stuff better and forcing them on that journey.
Powerful, compelling stuff, Nick. So, Sue, with visionaries like Nick at the helm, big business is going to sort it out. And when are you closing Quartet? Is charity dead?
Absolutely, yeah. We'll give up tomorrow, pack up, go home. It's actually interesting. You look back to the David Cameron years, so from 2010, the government really did have a downer on charity and said social enterprise is where it's at. That's what we want to encourage. We don't need to bother so much with charity and philanthropy. Since the new government's come in, Theresa May's actually brought in new people to her team who are just bedding in now, so it's early days, we'll wait and see what they say. But the early indications are that they are there to give her advice on volunteering, to give her advice on charities, and that although social enterprise is still a key part of the mix, charity and philanthropy has got attention back on the radar of government where it had disappeared for 6 years. So we're back. And the interesting thing I think about what, to go back to the point for discussion, yes, it's true that companies are slow, big companies are slow to change and make decisions. When they do change, of course, they have huge impact and they can change their business model if they want to. That's what the shareholders agree to. That's what the management can drive through. That's what will happen. But you look at the vast majority of small, local, good causes, they can't really change their business model. And I'll give you an example. We've given a grant recently through our Give a Monkeys project, which Nick and Engine Shed have very kindly supported for, well, all of last year and beyond. And that was a grant to the South Bristol Toy Library. Toy library, you think, well, why do people need to borrow toys in this day and age? We're talking about really disadvantaged people where mum and dad can't afford to go to Toys R Us and buy a load of new toys for their kids. But the toy library will lend them things so they actually get some stimulating new toys for the kids to play with. And not only that, but they do sessions with the parents on how to play with your child, which sounds basic, but there are people who really benefit from understanding how they can stimulate and interact with their children at a level that they don't know how to do organically. But once they get help and support to do it, it changes the lives and the outcomes of those children. So South Bristol Toy Library is, by its very nature, a free service. We give grants to it, as do others. If they said, let's turn into a social enterprise and start charging for the toys that we're lending out, it's not going to work. They cannot do that. They cannot become a social enterprise. Compare and contrast with perhaps St. Werburgh City Farm. They're a really good example of something that is an emerging social enterprise doing great work. They're not just a city farm, you sort of think about, you know, a couple of sheep, a couple of ducks and a goose or something. They're much bigger than that. They've got polytunnels where they grow food and then sell that into the local community. Now, they've got a cafe at the moment which is just leased out to somebody to operate on a commercial basis. They're wondering if they could bring that cafe in-house, put a new building on the back of it, and perhaps use it as a training kitchen for the adults with learning disabilities that they're already working with to learn skills in catering and then use the food that's made in the cafe on a commercial basis to sell to people who use the cafe as it is at the moment. So, you know, is that a model? Don't know. Would it work? Don't know. It obviously needs a lot of thinking through because you don't want to take the whole of the city farm down because you make a bad venture and you end up, you know, destroying what's already there. So there are options for the sector to do things that are more entrepreneurial, but you've got to be very cautious, and it certainly doesn't apply to everybody in the sector. The ones, we're doing some work at the moment with Helen Black and the other CVSs in the area, looking at the state of the third sector. There, what we found is that it's only 5% of the third sector organisations across the west of England that are in any way ready to take on board a social loan, become a social enterprise. So it's really quite low numbers. So something has to be there for the rest. And yes, charity is there for everybody else.
Okay, that's convinced me. Keep Quartet open, please. Thank you. I think it's about time where we opened it up to the floor. So if you could dream up some questions, that would be great. If you could say your name, if you have an organisation that you're speaking on behalf, an organisation, and if you'd like to target your question at any particular panel member, then please do, or create it as a general question. Why don't we do that thing where they take questions in three? So can I see three hands or more? So I've got one, two, a third or not, just two for the moment. A gent in the front first and then a gent at the back.
Right, so this is a kind of an agreement rather than a question.
Yeah.
So I'm Mike Jackson. I run a thing called Webstart, which is an incubator for early stage tech companies based here. But 5 years ago, I set up a charity with my wife to solve a particular social problem. We've received funding from Quartet, so thank you very much. And what I've tried to do with the charity, which I'm a trustee of, but more my wife runs, is to apply some commercial rigour to the charity sector. And I didn't know anything about the charity sector until I established one. And I've been pretty horrified by what I've seen in most charities. Just
The general lack of commercialisation. For a lot of charities, and the toy charity you mentioned, they don't necessarily need it because it's a very simple, straightforward thing. But some are trying and aspire to be more commercial. So what we've done is we've been very lucky to get good funding from both the Big Lottery and Comic Relief, which are doing amazing work. I think without those two institutions, you know, society would look very different today. But also, we've realised that the service that we're providing should actually be provided by the state through the NHS. It's a mental health service. So we've gone to the NHS at national level and said, you need to be commissioning. And after 5 years, we're about to be commissioned by Devon, North Devon, by South Gloss, by Gloss, and by Baines and Bristol. And that's taken a lot of work. And I've just been today doing a whole very complicated government spreadsheet of how to be commissioned. And it's hard, and if you're a normal charity, I think you need help. And I think for the business people in the room, there is a real need to engage with charities and help them fill in spreadsheets, which are actually the kind of normal thing I do every single day. But for someone running a charity, it's quite daunting. And I think that's somewhere we can step in and help pro bono work. A lot of the legal firms at Bristol do a lot of great pro bono work, but I think the accountants in particular could get more involved. They see charities as a way of making money, and they do help, and I work with a local company that helps, but there's more that could be done.
Great, thank you, Mike. That's appreciated.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, everyone. Is this on?
Hello,
yeah. I'm Mike Lloyd-Jones from Bristol Energy. We are a national gas and electricity supplier owned entirely by Bristol City Council. Just launched in February, and our aim is to be a force of social good, so kind of trying to be a new model of energy company whilst providing an important financial return to Bristol City Council and trying to alleviate fuel poverty, support renewables, that kind of thing. So throughout the year, it's been a difficult job balancing the social good. What is it to be a force of social good as an energy supplier? Especially with a shareholder like Bristol City Council. And it's been interesting to see that play out and try and strike that balance between the commercial and the social. And I think actually it's, hearing the conversation, it's actually a lot easier. Our job is made easier by the fact that our shareholder is one person who's the council, who wants a financial return, but also has embedded a culture of we have to deliver social good. And that's partly because the council needs to reduce its costs, and the more social good we deliver in terms of reducing fuel poverty, the fewer people will be in crisis, there are positive impacts on public health, that kind of thing. So there is a financial benefit to our shareholder there, so it's an unusual position. I'm wondering if the panel could, I think Nick spoke about it a little bit, whether the panel truly think that an existing large business, take a large big six supplier like E.ON or EDF or Centrica, could truly pivot to having a commercial and social mission. And if they have any examples, it doesn't have to be in energy, or any examples of a large corporate actually truly doing that, not just starting the journey, but getting some way there, and whether they could give us a few examples and elaborate.
Thanks, Mike. So examples of existing large businesses demonstrating a commercial and social mission intertwined. Nick, you're probably the best person for this one.
Yeah.
You want to go first?
Should I? Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
third question.
We've got a third question. I can't. Where is it?
Sorry.
Oh, there.
Sorry,
okay.
I snuck in and.
All right. Go for it.
Sorry. Hi. I'm.
Yeah. Just close your mouth. I am Daniel. So I'm a consultant and I work with social enterprises, charities, but also I've set up a couple of ones in the past. So I set up a community energy company a while ago, which was very pleased to see Bristol Energy here now. And I'm really passionate about this area, and I think it's a really interesting question, but it kind of says something about the sector that only people in the sector will really understand this question that we're asking. And I haven't got any Death Star analogies to offer. I hope to be toddling off in 2016 in the drunk. But my question is actually, what are we referring to in the question? Is this about existing businesses? Is this about startup? Is this about how we form ideas? And I think that's really important because the strongest social business models I've seen may not call themselves social enterprises, but operate like that and are actually using very commercial business ideas and very commercially minded people who are taking that forward with those skills. And there are some really, really strong small businesses which have come from community scale and have fought their way up, and you can just see it. You sit across a table with them and you know they've got the ambition to become more commercial and to actually deliver. So I'm kind of challenged by this one really, because I don't see many brands becoming that social, and I'd be really interested to hear more from you on that, Nick. Mm-hmm. I think there's a certain segment of a certain size to which it applies,
yeah.
And actually the rest, and you certainly aren't going to be able to sit across the table and say, hey, do you want to become a cooperative? You know, you're not going to win that conversation. But I think a really big question is actually how we support charities and social enterprises to become more commercial. Because Quartet, you know, just in a purely being more business-like and having to search for funding, the changes just happened, the impact fund with the council, all of this, the landscape's completely changing. So I'd really invite, like, what's the most important thing for what we'd like to see is probably my biggest question I've had for the panel.
Okay, in the name of time, can I farm these three questions out? So we'll go Mike's question up there to Nick, if that's all right.
If I could give you a bit, not just from Nick, but from...
Yeah, to start...
Can we do all of them really quickly? We all promised to be really
let's
quick.
Go. Yes.
Okay, I'm timing.
Rapid fire.
I'm timing. We've got 10 minutes.
Mike, so we're trying to teach, we're trying to help small local projects become more social, not necessarily more commercial. Because in becoming more social, that becomes very attractive to companies who might want to help. And you can organise your community, convene people, get people making their own contribution, getting volunteers, because we've created a platform that makes that easier. Second part of that is companies are increasingly turning to skills-based volunteering. They don't want to go and paint picket fences anymore. That was the CSR era. They now want to empower their people in the finance department who know how to build spreadsheets to come and help you one day ever, or one day a week, whatever your requirement. And then you've got companies like Barclays and the Digital Eagles who've got 12,000 Digital Eagles now, one in every single branch, I think, who are there for anyone to drop in and say, I need help with tech. Show me what to do. And they're all trained to help local communities get the best out of technology that's around. So I think it all comes back to the same objective, which is commercial, helping small charities be more commercial. Mike, what did I write down? Paul Polman, Unilever, day one in the job as CEO, said, I'm banning quarterly reporting, which was, of course, the targeted objective, which forced the business into short-termism, which comes back to that continual challenge of, I've got to deliver my numbers, I've got to deliver social purpose. In banning quarterly reporting, he gave himself space to build a 10-year Unilever Sustainable Living Plan. The day that he did it, the share price dropped. I'm making the numbers up. It was something like 40%. I know that within 2 years it was up something like 180%, and he can prove that every single brand in the USLP portfolio is outperforming the others because they're putting purpose ahead of profit. There's loads of examples like that, but Unilever are the standard bearer of who's doing this the best. Daniel, the last question. So big companies, I think, are, as we've discussed, are forced to change. I think smaller local companies, they've all got volunteering, they've all got amount of money to give. They're quite interested in joining in with some of these big campaigns. So if a company starts something really interesting, like Marks and Spencer sparks something good, and local councils, with their massive convening power, can say, actually, we endorse this program because we think it's good for the local community. And that leading brand says, hey, do you know what? It's fine for SMEs to come and join in because actually more power to all of us, we'll get more done. I think that makes it more inspiring, more fun, more reasons why smaller companies will get on the journey as well.
Thank you, Nick. Very concise. Ollie, can I call you in next?
Yeah, sure. So I'll pick up on the big brand question in terms of, you know, will big brands ever turn into cooperatives or whatnot? And I'm not sure it's ever going to be that kind of a U-turn, but just sort of a brief example, I had a colleague that I used to work with out of the States who never wore shoes and was absolutely, you know, for fighting for the planet, and he was, you know, that guy. And we had a proposal come through at Funsurfer from Coca-Cola to work with them. And I said to him, you know, check this out. There's no way we're going to ever work with Coca-Cola, right? You know, draining Indian villages of water and whatnot. You know, they're terrible. And he was the last person I expected to turn around to me and say, look, you can't be the guy that stands outside the Coca-Cola headquarters with his fingers in his ears saying, la, 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 I'm not going to work with Coca-Cola because they're a bad company. In his words, Coca-Cola, one of the only firms that actually deliver the money they promised to disasters. So they put 100 million cash into the tsunami disaster appeal, which is a lot more than most governments do when they, you know, promise the aid. And then when you actually go to check and see if has it been delivered, no, it hasn't. You know, that check was promised 5 billion. Yeah, it's going to come. Did it come? No. So Coca-Cola is an example of, yes, there's going to be people in there that in no way are going to be interested in supporting social enterprise. But as a company like for Funsurfer, I have to be prepared to go into the boardroom, maybe get some CEOs or some VPs in headlocks. I have done that at UBS and it worked like a charm because they said they'd put 22 billion into social investment. So a headlock does work. But Coca-Cola, you know, they're a good example of someone that, yeah, they're an enormous company and they have to be not attacked as such, but coerced, maybe pushed, suggested from companies like Funsurfer and Neighbourly and Social Enterprise Works to do more with their money. And I think that goes from the smallest company to the biggest company, and from the smallest charity to the biggest charity. You know, there is a need to collaborate wherever possible. I did make at the Small Charities Coalition a number of trustees cry. I wasn't proud of it. It was because the landscape had changed and they realized we're going to the wall and they have to become more commercial. They had no business plan, there's no marketing strategy, there's none of the things that you would find in a corporation or a business, and that has to change. So yeah, picking up on that, I think for the corporate side, for the small charities, there is possibility for collaboration, but we're going to have to fight for it.
Thank you, Ollie. I'm going to bring Carl in for a last comment from the panel, and then I'm going to do three quick show of hands from the audience.
Okay, so one thing we haven't mentioned, to go back to the question, and actually it's a really good, interesting example about Bristol Energy Company being owned by the council. We haven't talked yet about social value. And one of the things that I was thinking to myself just now, what are the levers for making change happen? What can we do as individuals and as organisations to bring about the change that we want to see in the world? Now, we've spoken about one side of us in the grassroots. If we all as individuals, we demand more. We demand more from our organisations. We be very values-driven with where we make our spend and where we spend our money. And that will start to have a ripple effect. The other side is institutionally, there's been legislation which is trying to encourage, initially within the public sector, although we've lobbied our local enterprise partnership to adopt this at a private sector level, that when contracts and tenders are issued, here in Bristol, £330 million worth of spend has been promised. They're going to ask a question about what additional social value and community benefit. Yes, you're going to build that road. What else are you going to do for the community? Now, on one hand, you could cynically say that the council are offsetting the cost to the private sector, and my apologies for that in advance. But on one hand, it's supposed to help level the playing field for, if we're looking for social organisations to be more commercial, to try and get into supply chains, to try and get out of fundraising mode, to try and get out of begging people for money, and even in it, alongside developing your products and services, to be able to land a 3 to 5 year contract to deliver in a sustainable way. So I think that's a really important thing, which increasingly, after the announcement earlier this year, our first call was from a national facilities management company that wanted us to broker them a relationship with a small social enterprise so they could try and score some points in their procurement process. Now, I tried to prevent any bid candy, which is likely to occur, I'm sure, but in principle, this is providing levers for us to grasp. And last, this thing about fighting for collaboration, and the wonderful example of suggestion of pro bono, I encounter people all the time that want to give and all the time that need. I'm constantly trying to ask them to speak to each other. And actually, whether it's capacity, I'm just so busy delivering that I have the head to look around and find and ask that question. But often encouraging people just to brazenly ask for the stuff that you want and need. Because if you don't, then you won't go anywhere fast. So that's my quick thoughts.
Thanks, Carl. Impassioned call there. So just briefly to end, before I hand back to Nick for some closing thoughts, the question or the statement was that it's easier to socialise the commercial than it is to commercialise the social. So I'm going to ask for three shows of hands. The first show of hand is if you agree with that statement. The second show of hands is if you disagree with that statement. And the third show of hands will be if you've no idea what that statement still means. So, do you agree with that statement? If you do, can you stick your hands up now, please? So it's easier to socialise the commercial, in other words, do the type of stuff that Nick is doing, than it is to commercialise the social, the kind of dragging the charity sector into the business world. So let's do a quick hand count. Yeah, panel members, you can vote as well if you like. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay. If you disagree with that statement, hands up, please, now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 22. And if you've got absolutely no idea what we're talking about, now put your hands up. Okay, that's half a dozen or so. So the nays have it, and with that I'll hand over to Nick. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you very much. First of all, can we thank the panel? You know, we could discuss this for a lot longer. It's an interesting topic. There's a lot more examples we can go into, and it would be good to hear some real case studies. Perhaps that's for another time. But I think if we don't stop soon, Ollie will put us in a deadlock, and then CSR really will be dead. Have we got an answer? You know, I think, did many people change their minds as part of that, or did we come with fixed? I think you understand less now.
It was nice.
It's good. It's really important for us, I think, to kind of challenge the assumption that has been the case that for profit is over here and not for profit is over here, and they can't learn. There is a spectrum. We've heard some examples and some of the challenges of what we need to do to bring that together so that we can have a more blended and values-driven society. So I hope that was useful. Thank you again, panel. Our next event in February is tagged Minding the Gap. So make about what you will. Sign up for that. And those of you who've booked, you're welcome to stay for drinks and networking, courtesy of Engine Shed and Corrigan Associates. If you haven't booked, no one's going to ask, but you're welcome to continue the conversation. Don't eat too much pizza if you haven't booked. But please do stay and continue the conversation. Thank you very much.